Hey guys, welcome to Kingsway. This is our second youth community night. Anyways, we're about to start off in the worship, and I'm just going to go ahead and open up into prayer, and then we'll get started. So thank you, Father, for everybody that came out tonight, everybody who's watching on the stream. We just love everybody, and we ask you guys to bless us and just pour out your spirit on everybody here tonight as we worship and just open up our hearts to you.
Your faithful. your faithfulness will never let me down. 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 Your faithfulness will never down. Your faithfulness will never let me down. Your faithfulness will never let me down, down, down. Never let me down. There's nothing that can stop your goodness now. There's nothing that can stop. Nothing can stop your goodness, God. I'm confident. Your faithfulness will never let me down. Your faithfulness is everlasting. It's everlasting.
It's everlasting. It'll never run out. His goodness never runs out.
Nothing can stop you now, God. There's nothing getting in the way. Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, always my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, always my song. You are good, good, oh, yeah, you are good, good, oh.
You are good.
never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You are king, king, oh. You are king, king, oh.
Show me your glory. marked by your beauty. And I'm lost in your eyes. I want to walk in your praises like Jesus did. Marked by your beauty, and I'm lost in your eyes. And I wanna walk in your presence like Jesus did. Yeah. Marked by your beauty.
Where I belong. belong. It's where I belong. It's where I belong. How long to look on the face of the one that I love? Want to stay in your presence where I belong? Want to look on the face of the one that I love? Want to stay in your presence?
Beside your presence. You know, in Psalm 91, it says that he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. That word dwell right there means to remain as a permanent resident. And that word secret means a place beyond any ordinary human understanding. So we're tonight, we want to remain as a permanent resident in the place that's beyond any ordinary human understanding, and that place is your presence. That place is your presence. We don't want our life to be anything without your presence, because it can't be. So I want you guys to go back into that one more time. I long to look at the face of the one that I love. And I want everybody to stand up, and I want you to just look at him. With your eyes, just look at him and sing that to him.
I long to look on the face of the one that I love. Want to stay in your presence where I belong. Want to look on the face of the one that I love. Want to stay in your presence where I belong. On today, in the face of the one that I love, on to stay in your presence where I belong. On to look on the face of the one that I love, on to stay in your presence where I belong. On to look I love, on to stay in your presence. I want to look on the face of the one that I love. Want to stay in your presence where I belong. Want to look on the face of the one that I love. Want to stay in
or three people and say, we belong in the presence together. All right, y'all, welcome to Kingsway Church. I'm Grace. Can we, first of all, just thank God for the band. Woo! Yay! Love them so. Welcome. We are so glad that you are here. We like to greet, so. So, yes, for the infinite time, welcome. Do we have any first-time visitors? If so, raise your hand. No? Yes? Yes. Hello. Welcome. Okay. What are y'all's names and where are you from?
Ila and Donald Mills from Mississippi.
Lovely. Woo! We have some lovely people from Mississippi. They sit over there. Anyway, yes. Welcome. We are so glad you're here. Our ushers have cards that you can get our lovely Mississippi bound and from Worship Leaders CD. Y'all do that because it will change your life. So, yes, yay. No more first-time visitors? No? All right. If I could have the kids come forward, please. If you're 12 and under, come on, come on. Yay. All right, so these are our kids. They're awesome. There's Amy. She's awesome, too. Okay, I'm just going to bless y'all, and then you can get out of here. All right. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for each and every child here. Lord, thank you just for the blessing that they are to each and every family here. Lord, I pray that you would just pour out your spirit just afresh and anew on them tonight. Lord, thank you for Amy, and thank you for what she has prepared, Lord, but I just thank you that you're just going to come and blow a fresh new wind on these spirits, Lord, that they would just see you how you want to be seen and how they want to be seen in you. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all have fun!
Have fun!
All right. Yes, so, good news, guys. We have a runner. It's okay. They'll get it. So, I know next week, I can't believe it. Thanksgiving is next week. It ran away from me. But next week is Thanksgiving on Thursday, yes. But we will still be having service on Wednesday. So y'all come out and give thanks pre-Thanksgiving.
Come on now.
So it'll be super fun. So yes, that's the announcement is, yes, we are having service next Wednesday. Y'all come out. I'm sure I'll be here. It'll be great. Okay. Thirdly, I think that's my third announcement. We are having an Iron Bowl party, and y'all... this girl screams Roll Tide, but like if you, that other thing, like that's okay too, kind of, for that night. So, so we're having an Iron Bowl party, y'all come. We're having wings and nachos and all those things that you eat when you watch a football game. So it's going to be in the cafe, it's going to be awesome, and we're starting at 2, and then kickoff's at 2:30. So you gotta come, festivate, and then cheer on your team. It'll be super fun. So lastly, we have this wonderful video announcement on this upcoming event called Christmas in the Park, and it's super cool, so.
Hey Kingsway family, I'm here with Michelle Franklin and his Hands of Grace ministry, and Kingsway and his Hands of Grace have been working together for 8 months now.
Glory.
Michelle and her team helping us here at Kingsway through our food ministry, and then also Kingsway partnering with his Hands of Grace and Michelle as she and her team feed the homeless, clothe the homeless, and love all the homeless of our city. And so we have an amazing opportunity coming up this holiday season to love our city in a very practical way. Michelle, tell us what's happening.
on December 17th, we're going to do Christmas in the Park. We're going to have a Christmas meal, a Santa, even though we're all grown up and we don't believe in him, there's children that believe in him. So we're going to have toys for the children, blankets and sleeping bags, and we would appreciate your help with this.
So Kingsway, here's what we need. We need you to bring blankets. We need you to bring sleeping bags. We need you to bring toys for children 18 months to 7 years old. And really anything that you feel would be a blessing to somebody who does not have a home. Things that are going to keep them warm at night, keep them encouraged through the day. And we want to invite you to join us December 17th for Christmas in the Park. Let's come together and minister His Hand of Grace with Michelle Franklin and His Hands of Grace Ministries. So again, you'll be able to drop off these items in the Connect Cafe from here all the way up to December 17th. Let's be the difference we want to see.
Yes.
This was fun. I'm going to give it away to the David Roberts for the offering.
What is up? So basically, kind of what God had laid on my heart to share tonight was the power of your yes and to not be afraid of your yes. But speaking of being afraid, who all likes to ride roller coasters? Well, a lot of you. I went to Six Flags this past summer with like the Hoopers, the Watleys, the McCains, and the Jenkins, and I hope I do not forget anybody. So I went, and I was just dying to ride the Goliath. Who all knows what the Goliath is?
Come on.
I love the, just for a head story, I love the Goliath. I rode it 3 times in a row, and it was a blast. And so when I got there, I think me and Ben got a little late, and we got in line together. And I was like, before I saw the Goliath, I was like, dude, let's ride the Goliath first. But when I got there and saw how tall that thing was, I was like, dude, I do not know if I can do this. And so I was just going on and on, just babbling about how scary it was, and I just did not want to do it. And how many times do we as Christians do that same thing when God says, hey, David, would you go peel this person's leg, or would you go give this girl a prophetic word, just an encouraging word, just because she's having a bad day? And so all God is saying is, sit down, buckle up, and trust me, because I'm going to take care of everything. And so if we're really abiding in the fact that He is the vine and we are the branch, then we shouldn't be afraid about whether our tree shakes or not, because we know how deep our roots go. And so I had a few bullet points that I just want to share real quick. The first one is, the Lord wants your yes. Are you willing to say yes to what you have not seen yet? And so, as some of you know, me and my brother Aaron have started this internship for about a month and a half now. And for me, about when I was a sophomore or a senior, I had this huge desire on my heart to go to Bethel in California, the BSSM college. And just, I was having this time with the Lord, and He just completely, he told me that I needed to lay down all of my plans for Bethel and the college to be fully committed to Kingsway. And so for a while, I had really kind of fought Him with that, because I had this huge desire to go and be a part of whatever He had called me to. And so one time I was on the stage on Sunday, and we were leading worship, and I was just kind of soaking in the presence. And He really just redirected my heart to what we had here at Kingsway, because sometimes if we go to whatever God is really manifesting in one area, we can also leave these other areas in the world really dry. And we also need to be, as some leaders are called to fill in those dry places and be able to sacrifice our family and our friends, such as I really look up to the Hoopers and the Watleys, who really did sacrifice their family and friends and everything that they had to say yes to the calling that God had for them. And so the next one that I had was, your yes is not only to help you grow, but it is also to help others succeed and to build them up in what they're called to do as well. And one time, we were living in Gadsden at the time, and my dad had asked me to go get a jug of milk from the gas station because we were out for breakfast in the morning. And so I drive in my car, I get in my car, and I pull up in the parking lot, and immediately God just drops this word in my heart, and He says, hey, you need to be prepared to do something, because there's something you need to do at the gas station. And so I was like, okay. And so I get my jug of milk, and immediately, as soon as I set my jug on the desk, the cashier says, man, just out of the blue, she was like, man, my neck is just hurting, like, so bad. I was like, well, that was easy. Didn't have to look too hard. But she was like, man, my neck is hurting so bad. And I was like, well, hey, are you a Christian? Do you go to church anywhere? She's like, yeah, I go to so-and-so. I can't remember what it was. But and I was like, well, can I pray for you? And she was like, yes, please. And I prayed for her, and nothing like super spontaneous happened. But as soon as I prayed for her, I could tell that this weight just completely lifted off of her, that someone actually took the time to invest in what she had and going on, invest in what was going on in her life. And so I had this one last point before I kind of close, but through the process of your yes, it is very tough, but it is that very process that is making you strong enough for when the time comes to reach that mountaintop that you shout his name and not your own.
Wow.
And so to kind of close, I just want to close with this Bible verse before they get the video up. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is the Lord, for he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river and will not fear when he comes. But its leaf will be green and will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will cease from yielding fruit. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings. And so as you're preparing your yes, before they get the video out, we just want to show you a video of this past Tuesday from Kingsway's yes. And you can make checks out to Kingsway Church. You can give by cash or credit card in the seat pocket in front of you. And so enjoy the video.
One of the things that I want to look at this morning with you is how the thief gets in. How he breaks into our life, how he breaks into our heart to steal, kill, and destroy. Because the thing about the enemy is he doesn't have any more power in your life or for your life than you give him. And I was praying this morning for you guys, a scripture in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 came up in my heart. And this is what it is. It says, keep your heart with all diligence. And oftentimes the enemy can come to your door and it can sound like something that's going to make you feel good in the moment. Instead of the Lord coming in and saying, hey, listen, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone opens up to me, I'll come into him and I will dine with him. And I want to tell you what dinner with Jesus looks like. He says, I will take of what is his and he can have what is mine. That means the Lord says, I'm going to take your problems. I'm going to give you my solution. I'm gonna take your pain and I'm gonna give you my healing. I'm gonna take your lack and I'm gonna give you my wholeness. I'm gonna take your destruction and I'm gonna give you my resurrection. But here it says in Proverbs chapter 4, and this is written by Solomon, and he was the wisest man who ever lived. Amen. He was David's son, and he says, keep your heart with all diligence. And I want to tell you, it's time, folks, that we keep our own heart with all diligence. Because out of it, say out of it, flows a river. And see, we need to make sure that's a clear river. That's a clean river. If today you say, Lord, I want you to come into my heart. I want you to become the Lord of my life. On the count of three, I want you to raise your hand. One, two, three. Raise your hand. Come on. Thank the Lord for these guys. If your hand's up, I want you to stand up right now. Let's say this together. Say, Lord Jesus, I surrender my life to you. I receive your grace. I receive your new heart. I ask you, in the name of Jesus, to make my heart your home. Now, Holy Spirit, I ask you to fill me to overflow. If you're here this morning, you need physical healing in your body. Raise your hand. Because the Lord's going to begin to blow through here with healing. If you need healing, go ahead and stand up right now. I want everybody who's around these folks, if you're sitting around them, stand up and get as close to them as you can. Put your hand on them right now, okay? So on the count of three, we're going to say, be healed in Jesus' name. Ready? One, two, three. Be healed in Jesus' name. If signs and symptoms and pain have left your body, just start waving your hand right now.
My hip pain is gone.
Your hip pain is gone. Come on, Jocelyn's hip pain. How long have you had that hip pain?
about 10 years.
Did y'all hear that? 10-year pain has left Jocelyn's body. On a scale of 1 to 10, how bad was it?
I'm taking shots for it.
She was taking shots for the pain because the pain was so bad. And all of a sudden, right there, when her friends prayed for her, the pain left. What'd you feel, ma'am? Pain left your back. Amen. What was it on a scale of 1 to 10 before? It was a 9. Pain left her back. Anyone back here? And so what was the issue with the nerve damage in your hand?
I feel that he said jammed it up pretty good.
You jammed up the nerves? Squeeze my hand. You couldn't do that before? Come on. Thank you, Jesus. That's a creative miracle because it's nerve endings and nerve damage. Come on. Let's give glory to him, Angela.
Both of my knees were hurting when I came, and I feel so good and feel full with Jesus.
Yeah, Jesus, come on now. Mary said that her knees got healed and she's full of Jesus now. But now together, come on, let's begin to thank him and become whole. Come on, just begin to thank him right now. All across the room right now, just begin to give him thanks. Come on, open up your mouth. Come on, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, you came to make us whole. You didn't just come to heal us, but you made us whole in Jesus' name.
God did so many things last Tuesday. If you would love to join us, we do it. I cannot remember. What is it? Tuesdays? And when do we do it?
First and third Tuesdays.
First and third Tuesdays.
December 6th
is
the next day.
December 6th is the next day. So if you have your offering prepared, we would love for you to stand up and I'll pray for you. Lord Jesus, we just thank you for the willing hearts of your kingdom to say yes to you.
Yeah.
We thank you for the people who have the call. And we pray for people who are struggling with their yes, that you would drop a seed in their heart for more of you and more of your presence, Lord. We thank you for the secret place. And we thank you for loving you more, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
I don't want to ride on somebody else's passion. I don't want to find that I'm just dry bones. I want to burn with unquenchable fire. Deep down inside, see it coming alive. I don't want to ride on somebody else's passion. I don't want to find that I'm just dry bones. I want to burn with unquenchable fire. Deep down inside, see it coming alive. Help me find my own flame. Help me find my own fire. I want the real thing. I want your burning desire. I don't want to ride on somebody else's passion. I don't want to find that I'm just dry bones. I want to burn with unquenchable fire. Deep down inside, see it coming alive. I don't want to ride on somebody else's passion. I don't want to find that I'm just dry bones. I want to burn with unquenchable fire. Deep down inside, see it coming alive. Help me find my own flame. Help me find my own fire. I want the real thing. I want your burning desire. Help me find my own flame. Help me find my own fire. Oh, I want the real thing. I want your burning desire. Do what only you can do in my heart tonight. Do what only you can do in my heart tonight. Do what only you can do in my heart tonight. Do what only you can do in my heart tonight. There's no better time. There's no better time. There's no better time. There's no better time. Oh, there's no better time. There's no better time. There's no better time. Oh, help me find my own flame. Help me find my own fire. Oh, I want the real thing. I want your burning desire. Help me find my own flame. Help me find my own fire. I want the real thing. I want your burning desire.
Amen.
Amen.
That's my brother. That was my other brother, too. They are super awesome. I'm so proud of them. Man, I was just driving down this road the other day where that back road is, that big hill, and I just was going down that hill, and I really just like stopped to think like how stupid it is that I get to do what, you know, the Lord has blessed me with being able to do. Like, not many people get to, you know, lead worship and lead students and just be in a church literally 7 days a week for a living. And so I just was like, man, God, you are so awesome. Thank you for just this blessing. So I just wanted to say that because it was something that happened to me the other day, and I just hardly ever take the time to think about what I get to do. And I'm like, man, that was awesome. But I just wanted to take tonight, I have kind of a word that's just an encouraging word that the Lord kind of placed in my heart. Also kind of filling in you guys, kind of what we've been talking about and starting to do more upstairs with the youth. About a week, 2 weeks ago, Ashton and I sat down together, and we, for the last few months since the beginning of June, have been blessed with being able to be youth pastors of these awesome students. And we have, I'm speaking for myself, and I'm sure I can speak for Ashton, that we have grown just so much in the last few months and just learning all about it. And so, but the last couple of weeks, we kind of sat down and we were like, we really want to push this forward on our list of priorities and really start being intentional about how those Wednesday nights go. And so we asked ourselves a question, or a couple of questions, and it was, how can we set these students up for an encounter? Because, I mean, if you expect people to come in to where you are and just automatically, you know, boom, like it's not going to happen. You have to, if you are a leader in someone's life, it's your job to set them up for success, to set them up for an encounter. And so we thought about it, and so we were like, Ashton said that it was really on her heart to start kind of a serious type of thing. I really don't like that word because it sounds limiting, but it is kind of a process of learning about prayer and fasting on a level that these students could really thrive and understand it. And so I was like, well, what's on your heart? Like, what is it that you feel like we should be praying and fasting for? Because if you're, you know, going on, you know, if you just limit the food intake for a period of time, you're just really going on like an intense diet if you're not really looking, you know, if there's not an end goal, there's not a vision. And so I was like, well, what was it on your heart that we should be praying and fasting for? And so she said, I really have wanted to see revival in the local schools that these students are going to, and the friend groups that they're around. I really want to see that spark catch. Yeah. And so we started the first week talking about Esther, because if that's not, you know, a prime example of the successes of prayer and fasting, I don't know what is, because she, you know, knew that her entire people was in danger because of the situation. And so she said to her cousin Mordecai, we need to pray and fast. And so they did that, and it saved an entire nation. Praying and fasting saved their whole nation. I mean, that, and then the boldness of Esther along with that, but just that primed that pump for that success. And so we really saw, we knew we couldn't give those students our experiences growing up. You know, we, like I said, we, you can't force this upon someone, but we really wanted to go into a kind of a serious type of thing where we could help them more and better understand the purpose and the why and such of prayer and fasting. And so that was really kind of what turned my heart to youth ministry, because at first it wasn't on my agenda to be a youth pastor per se. I remember in the meeting that I had with Jason and Jeff, in which they were telling me they really thought that I was supposed to be, Asher and I were supposed to be youth pastors. Before they said it, I'm going, don't say pastor, don't say youth pastor, don't say it, please, no. And so finally there's like, you know, we feel like you're supposed to be our youth pastor. And I was like, oh man, that was like a knife or something. Like, it was just not what I wanted at that time. And so I left, and that whole week I'm going like, man, like, that's not where I saw myself. And I had even received like a prophetic word from Michael French before I went back to Kansas City the fall before I moved back here, saying the dream that you have exists, but it's not going to look like what you thought it was going to look like. And so I was really afraid of that prophetic word. And so but that week after they, you know, they let me know, the Lord really turned my heart, and it was to see students on fire for the Lord and spreading that flame to their school. So then the Hewitt Trustful is just like on fire, and, you know, Mountain Brook is on fire. And so he said, I've not called you to babysit students with pizza and Xbox. I've called you to raise up this generation to be who I've called them to be. Like worshipers, warriors, and kings, like Jason was talking about last Sunday. And so it's so awesome. It was the Sunday before last Sunday, not 4 days after our first, you know, lesson on prayer and fasting, not 4 days later, a teacher from, I may need some coaching on the, Irondale Middle is at Kingsway, and she approached Jason, and she was like, we have been, me and some of the other teachers at Irondale Middle have been praying for years and years and years for revival to come to this school. Can you help? They came to us. Like, what? Not 4 days after we started talking about this being the goal. And so only God can orchestrate that. I was just so encouraged by that. It's like not something that just happens. Like, that just really got me so excited. And so it's like, in John 17, how many of you know that Jesus gets his prayers answered? That's just the way it goes. And so Jesus it's in scripture that Jesus only said what he prayed what he heard the Father praying. I always trip up on that one. But so when we pray, it's also in scripture that when you ask in my name, I will give it to you. And it's the same thing. When you pray the Father's heart, when you pray what you know is on his heart, he'll release it. Yeah. And so when Jesus in John 17 he's praying for us, he's praying for his disciples, he said, I want them to know me, all of this stuff, it's encouraging because God is going to give that to him because he prayed the Father's heart, and it says that if we pray the Father's heart, he'll give it to us. And so it's the same thing when we can be encouraged in that when we've discovered now that God has given us this piece of information, Irondale Middle came to us asking for our help in instilling a flame in their students after we have just 4 days prior said, this is what we want to sow into. And God says, here's this token. You're going in the right direction. You know that what you're praying for is going to happen. And so, which, like, my mind is big, and like my expectations are large, which means that, you know, the Lord's expectations and plans are bigger. And so it's like when I'm looking at an entire high schools and middle schools on fire for Jesus and he's got something more, I'm praying into that. And if he says that it's going to happen, then I'm excited. So yeah. It's like when David face Goliath, he knew he couldn't fail, because before he was just anointed by the prophet Samuel. He said, "You are anointed to be the next king of Israel." And so when Jesse sends David to the camp where his brothers are fighting to give food, David shows up and all of the soldiers are trembling and they're like, "What do we do?" And David's like, "There's this guy blaspheming and speaking against what you believe in. Like, what are you doing? Like, do you know who you are?" And so David is like, "I'll do it." Because, like, he walks up to Goliath and he's probably like, "It sucks to be you, because I can't die today, because I know something that God promised me hasn't happened yet." Excuse me. And so we can walk in confidence when the Lord has shown us. I kind of hesitated and I just went for it. But when you know that the Lord has promised you something, you can step into it, because when you pray into it, when you step into it, you can walk in confidence, because he will cover you with protection. Yeah. Nothing can happen when you are in the promise of the Lord. And so that's the encouraging word that I had for you guys. Just want to pray into that really quick. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we do pray that you would instill this flame, spark this flame within these students, within this body, not just students, but that's the step we're taking now. But we want to see this entire city, this entire region. Yes. Esther saved her entire nation with this prayer and fasting. And so we ask that you would just intervene and fall down and fill up the people of Birmingham, Alabama, with your spirit. Yes. Like it hasn't seen before. In Jesus' name. Yes. And so, without further ado, the Apostle Ashton Purcell.
Yeah. That was so good. Yeah. Oh my gosh, that was so good.
Come on. Good.
Man, I was talking with Tina when I got the text message from Ben. "Hey, if you're still here, come to the cafe." And I was like, "Nah." Because I was like in a really important conversation, and then Sam walked in. He was like, "Hey, my dad wants you." I was like, okay. So I walked in there and like there's this huge prayer meeting going on. I was like, oh my gosh, that was when we were praying for the teacher at Irondale Middle. So that was just a dream come true to watch that happen. So it was awesome. So we have one more announcement that we forgot to say earlier. Tomorrow is our first youth pizza and prayer. I don't know if we're calling it that, but I just did. We're going to have pizza at 6:00 in the cafe, and then at 6:30. Right? We're going to go and hear and pray into what he just said. We're going to go into pray about different local high schools and stuff like that. So if you're from 13 to 18, we want you here tomorrow at 6:00 to have some pizza and go into prayer with us. That sound great? Awesome. All right. So I'm going to be talking about a super familiar scripture. It's in Matthew 16:24. If you guys want to put that on the screen. It says, "And then Jesus said to his disciples, 'If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me.'" So I just want to take just a few minutes tonight and talk about what it means to deny yourself, what it means to take up your cross, and what it means to follow him really fast. All right. So as you guys probably saw during the transition, I absolutely love to break down what words mean. I love to find the definition of a word. I think it's in The Princess Bride when the dude's like, "You keep saying this word, but I don't think you know what it means." I love to watch people say words that they have no idea what the definition is, just because it sounds fancy. But I'm a lover of English, so I love to see what words mean. So that word deny means to refuse the existence of. And I've heard for years people teach on this scripture, and they made it really depressing and really like you got to kill yourself every day. And I'm not going to do that. I'm going to show some light in the scripture. For me, self is just anything that's not what God called you to be. It's refusing the existence of anything that God did not call you to be. And so when you're walking in self, you're walking outside of what God called you to be. And a few weeks ago, Suzanne gave me this incredible word of my life, and I'm not going to share a lot of it, but after she gave it to me, I saw this picture of this potter, who is obviously God, sitting down with some clay, and he was molding this person, and when he finished, he kind of stood up, and he looked at it, and he smiled, and he was like, that's good. And so there's this person of clay sitting on this table, and all of a sudden, I began to see all these things begin to be added to it. And after a while, I could no longer see what the original masterpiece was because all of these other things got added to it. And then I saw myself sit down and begin to pick away all those other things until it was back to its original state. Wow. And so basically for me, denying self is going through that process of picking off all of these other things. Okay. That it's picking off every wrong mindset. It's picking off every lie that someone told you about yourself that you believed. And so it's going through, like Genesis 22 talks about when Jacob wrestled with, some people say angels, some people say God, some people say Israel. I don't know. But it's the time that he went from being called Jacob to being called Israel. He, for his whole life, he was called this one name, but this one face-to-face encounter with the Lord, it produced this new identity for him. And so it's going through that, and it's having this face-to-face encounter with the Lord, and you're seeing the image of God, and you cannot walk in an image that you've never seen before. And so denying self just looks like breaking away mindsets, and it's refusing the existence of lies. And it's going, John 1 says that in the beginning was the Word, and that word means a word uttered by a living voice. And so it's taking that beginning word that when God created you, he spoke something over you. And it's going back to that original, because like life gets in the way. People speak things over you and you take it as your own. And so it's going through this process of just saying, no, that's not who I am. I'm going to push that away. And so when you step outside of that word from God, you're walking in self. And so self in and of itself is just a mindset. And so in order to deny self, you're just denying mindsets and lies. And the way that you deny these mindsets is you think on purpose. We were in women's Bible study a few weeks ago, and Julie McCain started talking about thinking on purpose, and that has changed so much about me, because it's, and the way that you do that is you do Philippians 4:8 that says, think on whatever things are true. It's think on whatever things are honorable and whatever things are just and they're pure and lovely and commendable. And it's because if you what you focus on grows. Pastor Jason tells us that all the time. And so if you focus on a lie, it's going to grow in your life. But if you focus on truth, that's what's going to grow. Right. Does that make sense? Yeah.
Good word.
So that's what self is. That's how you deny self. You deny those things. And so the next part of this is, can someone give me some water? Yeah. I am super like cotton mouthed. To take up your cross. I want you to understand that Jesus, thank you, Grace, Jesus did not say, take up my cross. He said, take up yours. So what, for Jesus, what was the cross? It was the reason he came here. It was his ultimate purpose here. Thank you so much, bud. Oh, you gave me two. That's awesome. Yeah. Okay, it was the reason he came here, right? And so when Jesus was just talking to his disciples, prophesying about his death and that he was going to be raised on the third day. And then, so right after that is when he makes this statement, come take up your cross. What he means by that, he's not actually meaning his cross. He's meaning yours. And so if the cross to him means his ultimate purpose, the reason he was here, your cross is your ultimate purpose. It's the reason that you're here.
Wow.
It's taking that very thing that you were created to be, and it's putting that on just like it's a garment. And so some gospels talk about this, and they use the word take up your cross daily. It's every morning putting on what God said about you. And that beginning word that we talked about in John 1, and that beginning word, what did he speak to you? And you acknowledge that every morning and say, I'm going to put this on. Because I think it was Dutch Seats that said, if this generation ever understood exactly what they were called to be, they would never make the statement, I'm bored. And so if you ever understand what God's called you to be, you'll carry that. You'll carry yourself different. Like when you come into, like you get this prophetic word that you're supposed to be a preacher or a prophet or whatever, you carry yourself different after you hear that, right? When you come into places, you understand that's who you are. Does that make sense? And so I want you guys to understand that this church It cannot be all that it's called to be if the people do not walk in what they're individually called to be. Amen. It'll always feel like something's missing. Salt really does, and we were talking about salt this week. Salt really doesn't seem that important until you forget to put it in something. Or you put too much in it. I'm going to tell a funny story about my dad real fast. So there was one day he was making instant mashed potatoes, and he misread the box, and he put as much flakes as you were supposed to put in. He put that much salt. Butter, my bad. And so he was like, I put too much salt in this. My mom's like, oh, it's okay, I like salty mashed potatoes. She took one bite and was like, never mind. Not that much. So you don't realize how much your part matters until it's there. And so we miss you when you're not here. We miss you when you don't step into who you're called to be. All right? I moved through this real fast. This is great. All right, the next part I'm going to talk about is the follow me part. So it's denying everything that you're not supposed to be. It's putting on everything that you are, and it's following Jesus. And so the word follow, I'm going to break down a few more words for you. The word follow means to join as his attendant. And the word attendant is a person employed to provide a service to the public in a particular place. A synonym for the word service is kindness, and the word kindness means compassion. And so it's joining with Jesus to provide compassion to the public in a particular place. Wow. And so that's what it means to follow Jesus. So I just want to say that your particular place is wherever you happen to be at any given moment. So right now, your particular place is Kingsway Church. When you leave here and go get something to eat, that restaurant is your particular place. When you go to work tomorrow, that's your particular place. When you go to school tomorrow, that's your particular place. It's wherever you happen to be. And so to follow Jesus, what that means is to provide compassion wherever you are. And so we were in women's Bible study this past week. And I'm going to make a public service announcement. I told Tina I was going to do this. If you're a lady and you have the ability to be here on Fridays, please come. I don't know why you wouldn't. It's so great. Man, I didn't get to be a part of Keep Your Love On, but I've been able to be a part of every powerful and free session that we've had, and it is making me powerful and free. Come on. There's so much that happens. The ministry time, the table time, I think is what we call it. It's amazing. So if you can be here, please come. You won't regret it. It's awesome. So this past week when we were, Tina was getting us to do this exercise, and in this exercise, I heard the Lord ask me this question. He said, what does it look like to find compassion for someone in the first 10 seconds of encountering them? It was a deep question. I didn't know the answer. And so for me, what I think that looks like, it's looking at someone and it's seeing them the way that Jesus sees them. And compassion is an action word. It's a verb. It's doing something with that compassion. It's Heidi Baker penned the question, what does love look like? Or love looks like something. And so we ask the question, what does love look like? And it's everywhere you go asking God, when I'm here, what does love look like? Yeah. When I go to the gas station and I'm there for, 15 minutes at the most, what can I do to show love when I'm here? And it's making just this conscious mindset of always, God, what does love look like? What does compassion look like in this moment? And 10 times in the gospel, it talks about Jesus having compassion. And 5 of those times, it says that he was moved with compassion. And that word moved means to change your position. So he changed his position with compassion. Good. And so Kingsway Church has compassion. I mean, obviously, looking at that food ministry video, you see that we have compassion. But I think we're moving into a place of being moved by compassion. It's having a physical response to that perspective of, it's having a physical response to the perspective of the Father. Does that make sense? It's having a physical response to the perspective of the Father. And so it's physically doing something with compassion. And I want you to understand that everyone's compassion looks different than another person. So my compassion doesn't look like Pastor Jason's compassion. Your compassion's not going to look like mine. And it's just getting along with the Lord and just getting that word that says, God, who am I? And what does my compassion look like? Because Kingsway Church will never move in the compassion that it's called to move in until we individually step up and move in the compassion we're called to move in. And then we can corporately come together and do something huge because we individually have it. We've corporately caught this compassion. Does that make sense?
Yes.
All right. And so I'm going to, that was really fast. Proud of myself.
Awesome.
I didn't want to take too long with that. And so I'm going to get our students to come stand up in the front. And so I want to challenge you guys to take this compassion challenge. And so it was really amazing that the week that we talked about Esther, when I saw the compassion be ignited in our students, when we talked about, you know, Esther saw her nation change, you can see her school change. There was a light that went off when we were talking about that. And so I want these guys to impart to you guys this compassion. So Jeff, if you can come play, that would be awesome. So if you're here tonight and you say, I want to accept this challenge of compassion, we want to pray for you.
Yeah.
So if you guys just want to come up
come
and just pick yeah. whoever you want to pick to pray for you, go ahead.
Put it on the bearded one.
Thank you.
when I heard your voice, and when you said my name, when I heard your voice, my heart began. When I heard your voice, and when you said my name, when I heard your voice, my
got a few that are still praying, but we have some very special guests in the house tonight. We have a couple of pastors from Mississippi here. So Donna and Mylon, if you guys will come up to the front, we want to pray for you. When I was talking to you guys earlier, I really felt that my parents had something to impart to you guys. So if I can get my parents to come, if we can get the whole congregation to come around and just pray for these guys and impart to them, it's going to be awesome.
All right.
Yeah.
I tell you, this is what I heard. I heard the word this season for you is the word fresh. That it's like a fresh encounter, fresh bread. Yeah. It's like I can smell fresh bread when I look at you. And there is an absolute just a freshness from the anointing, from the presence. It's like everything, like fresh oil. There's like a fresh wind. There's a fresh encounter. There's a fresh place that the Lord's going to take you to. And it's just an honor to be able to pray for you, with you, and partner with you in this house. And also, my daughter likes to break words down. I think she kind of got that from me, but we won't say anything about that. But the scripture that kept coming to my heart was the word redeeming the time.
Yeah.
And the word time there's two Greek words in the New Testament for time, and it's chronos and kairos. And chronos is chronological. It's something that you can't redeem. You can't redeem time, can't redeem what happened in the past. But kairos is an expected time or a season of time. And it's like God said, He's going to give you an opportunity in the city that you're in that you're going to be able to redeem. You're going to be able to bring it back to its original state, its original meaning, its original purpose. That He's going to give you that opportunity to redeem it in this kairos moment. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank You for the impartation of faith, Lord, that's going to rest in this house. And from this house, God, to these people, Father, we thank You for the power of the Holy Spirit, for what You're going to release in this city. God, we thank You that Mississippi will never be the same. That, God, the things that it was known for, it will no longer be known for. But, Lord, You're going to give an impartation, a time, Lord, to redeem every moment, Lord, that they step into. God, we give You honor for it, and we give You praise for it, and we give You glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Man. Wow. Roraba sikobo shekerebesete. Robo sela baba yamando roshekerebesketebata. Roboske bebeke mabasende la baba shekerebesete. Yeah. Fresh oil, fresh oil. Fresh wind. Fresh encounter.
Yes.
Lord, we call fresh harvest, Lord. Fresh compassion, Father. We thank You. We thank You. Holy Spirit, we thank You that all things that pertain to life and godliness is already deposited on the inside of them. Everything that they will need to reach the harvest that they have been called to reach has already been deposited on the inside of them. And we call that forth in Jesus' name.
If I have to carry this one more day, I'm going to burst. I'm gonna burst, but you're about to birth the babies. There's more than one. You've been carrying a bunch of babies. It's a multiple pregnancy, and you didn't think you're gonna make it, but you are. The other thing I believe I'm hearing you say is the Lord says there's an anointing on you guys to break generations of racism and classism in Hattiesburg. He's going to download strategies with you guys that are going to just break down walls and build bridges. Breaking down the walls of fear and building bridges of grace and love and honor and respect and partnership and cooperation. Breaking down walls of competition. And I see a new understanding of cooperation between the churches. And the Lord's saying, hold fast to Me. Hold fast to Me. This is going to happen, y'all. This is going to happen. The Lord's saying, I've been waiting over 40 years. I've been waiting a lot longer than that for this to happen. I tried to call people 40 years ago, and they twiddled their thumbs. But I'm calling you now. No more thumb twiddling. Y'all are willing. I'm seeing willing servants, willing vessels. I sense that there's some college ministries He's going to connect you with. Just pray into that.
The other thing I heard was that He's sending fresh troops to undergird you and hold and lift you up. We just bless the fresh troops that are coming. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord.
And Father, right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, we just release one gigantic impartation to Milan and to Donna and to the Hattiesburg, Mississippi area right now. Father, everything that You placed upon us as a family and as a church, we just send it with them now. In the name of Jesus, signed, sealed, and delivered. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a shout of praise. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord. And let's thank the Lord for our amazing Kingsway youth. Can we thank the Lord for what he's doing in our youth and in our schools? We have the best family on the planet. Sure.
I'm getting one more thing for you. I'm sorry, I can't remember your name.
Mylon.
I just kept hearing that the Lord said, she's having the babies, but you're the spiritual pediatrician. You're the one who's got an anointing to take sick spiritual children. You know, those in the kingdom are not thriving, those who are not doing well. You've got a healing anointing on people who've been really messed up and stuck in spiritual immaturity. And that healing is going to help them to grow up.
Amen and amen. Hey, if the Lord gave you something for Mylon and Donna, be sure to give it to them before you leave. If you have children and King's Kids, let's be sure to go pick them up as well. We love you so much. Again, ladies, don't forget Friday. We've got our women's Bible study. We'll see you Sunday morning. And we love you so much.